Please talk it up, talk a little, because it's going to be part of the eight. This is Paula, and tell them what you're doing, Paula. I'm going to put it on mute, the television.
We're going on Manhattan spot, Barbara Roosevelt, thank God. We can't be here tonight because it's starting to pour.
Talk up, talk up.
Okay, let me come closer.
Speak up, project.
I don't have a very good
there you go.
Voice, however, until my voice goes out, I'm kind of having a cold.
Oh, okay.
We're going to be setting up tonight because we're going to be having
Maqbool Mohammad.
He's a Pashtun military career officer, and we're going to be streaming on Ustream.
Yes.
Barbara Rosenfeld set it up for us, and you can find it on ustream.com/mini.tv.
Yeah, we'll probably start, yeah. So we're just setting up now, and we're watching a very apropos thing on C-SPAN about General McChrystal's report on Afghanistan and what the man has to say tonight with about the 43 million Pashtuns that overlap the border of Pakistan and Afghanistan is very apropos and tremendously significant report he's given to President Obama. They're considering a new strategy there. So, okay, so I'm going to put this on pause now, and it seems to be working, and stop.
We're there. I'm a Pashtun, so we say, you know, we are probably one of the best people. And it's a fact that Pashtuns are, in their own way, in their own traditions, very, very good people. Now, there's something that I didn't really cover in my interview, and that was, why do we have so many Pashtuns on each side of the border? Pashtuns, ethnically, linguistically, they are the biggest, they're the largest lineage today in the world.
Hmm.
They are the largest lineage today in the world. And when I say that, a Pashtun lineage starts from the family, where you say, my brother is going to stand by me, and my cousin is my enemy. And then it goes slightly beyond that, where you say, my cousin is going to stand by me from anyone outside within the tribe. And then you say, my tribe is going to stand by me from anyone outside the tribe. And then you say, every Pashtun is going to stand by me when Pashtuns are attacked. That is, it is, this is the culture of this more than 40 million people. That's how they're bonded together. Their being enemies start at the lowest level of relationship, where beyond your brother, everybody is your enemy. You know, there is a word called tarbur. Tarbur is a Pashto word which has two meanings. Tarbur means, this is my cousin, but tarbur also means, this is my enemy.
Hmm.
So this is the largest lineage that you have around the world. Pashtuns are divided by something called Durand line. I don't know if I'm wrong with that pronunciation, but
Durand
line. And Durand line was drawn in 1893 between the British and the Afghan ruler of that time, that the British Empire ends here. And this was after the second or third Afghan war, where the British, you know, tried their best to go into as much of Pashtun area as they could, or Afghanistan as they could, but, you know, they were all the time, they went up to Kabul and they came, went beyond that, but then they were beaten back. So at some point they said, listen, we have to now lay this line. And this Durand line was basically a buffer, to create a buffer state between the then Russia and the British Empire. This is how this belt was created. And then this Durand line became the border between Afghanistan and Pakistan when the British left India. There have been a lot of conflict between the two countries over this Durand line, that whether the Northwest Frontier Province is a legitimate part of Pakistan or not. But as per all the resolutions, General Assembly, United States, every country agreed on it that whatever was decided at the time of partition makes the border. This is the legitimate border between these two countries. That's how this line separates the ethnic Pashtuns from each other. And then we have this belt, which is called federally administered tribal area. This is what you have heard. You must have heard a lot. This is the belt, which is sort of, we're all saying it is out of law. They're all out, you know, because it doesn't fall within the direct jurisdiction of Pakistan, which is a misconception. It is a part of Pakistan. FATA are federally administered tribal areas out of Pakistan, but they're governed by a different tool, which is called Frontier Crime Regulation, FCR. Frontier Crime Regulation, am I right?
Yeah.
FCR.
There's a different law that...
There's a different law. But this law came from the British time, and Pakistan respected it because Pakistan said, the status that you have, we would respect that status of people. So this is a belt. And this belt, which is now infested with all the violence, used to be the most peaceful area. Despite all the poverty that they had, the 95% population of this area is rural. Only 4% is urban. So you can imagine most of them live in villages and they go by. They have their own code of conduct, they have their own tribal laws, and they have been having peace in that tribal region for centuries. Except that now it has become infested with all these problems. Pashtuns traditionally have been, if you look at Pashtuns within the context of Pakistan, these are the people who, where a child is born, they say a Pashtun child is born with a weapon. Every Pashtun sort of, when you grow up with a weapon in your hand. But this is because of the way they have been. But in their character, they're very peaceful. Pashtuns are known for their hospitality. They're known for hosting people, and if you go into a Pashtun's house, the Pashtun would be killed before anybody can come and harm you. They would shelter. This is how the Pashtun culture has evolved over centuries. And it goes, the saying is that it goes something like hundreds of years before Christ, when Alexander the Great came into this area. Mm-hmm. It was called something like Paktaya and
Bactria.
I can't pronounce.
Bactria.
Exactly, and this was a word for Pashtun. And then in the seventh century, Muslims came and Islam was introduced into this area. And after that, there have been a lot of changes. It was in 1917 where the modern Afghanistan came into being. There was Ahmad Shah Durrani, who used to be Ahmad Shah Abdali, actually. That's where the modern Afghanistan, and that's where there was a clear distinction between Afghanistan and the British Empire.
I want to clarify, you're saying Pashtuns are pre-Islamic?
Pashtuns are pre-Islamic.
Way back.
I mean, there's a tribe in Pashtuns, Afridis, who are supposed to be the descendants of Alexander the Great. Mm-hmm.
And what religion were they before Islam? Sufis? Were they Sufis?
Well,
no.
I mean, before I really haven't gone into
Zoroastrian. Maybe they were Zoroastrian. He's one of the last of the Zoroastrians.
Not only Zoroastrian, there was Zoroastrians also. Actually, there was no Afghanistan at that time.
Right.
There was the bigger sort of state, so to say, at that time. There was no nation state, concept of nation state.
Right.
At that time were, of course, Persia. Mm-hmm. On the other side of Persia was the Ottoman Empire. Mm-hmm. And on this side was the Mughal Empire. And before the Mughal Empire, it was the sort of India. Mm-hmm. And we are talking of pre-Islamic, when, of course, there were the Achaemenians and Sassanites in Persia. And in India also, there were the pre-Islamic rulers. Afghanistan, parts of it were always under the Indian rulers, and parts of it were under the Persian rulers, mostly. Kabul and Kandahar would often be under India's, either sometimes sovereignty, sometimes suzerainty. And western and northwestern Afghanistan would be more often under the Persian rulers, pre-Islamic. And even pre-Christian, before Christ.
Right.
And Zoroastrianism was a major religion at that time, but another very big religion in what is today Afghanistan and parts of Pakistan's northwestern frontier was Buddhism.
Buddhism
actually grew
from the 5th century BC
in that part of the world. And Gandhara, this area was called Gandhara, what is...
Kandahar.
Gandhara was the area in which Buddhism actually grew and became a strong religion. That's why you had those two Buddhas, you know,
which were destroyed by Bali,
in Bamiyan, if you recall. So Pashtuns are a very sort of ancient people. They're not new, and they're not post-Islamic.
Are they associated with Iran? I'm not with Persia.
They are. Yeah. I mean, Ahmad Shah Abdali. That was they came from Persia. That they are associated. But the other thing is that, like I said in my interview, that they're also thought to be a lost tribe of Israel.
That's also part of the list.
It's a part. Yeah. There's a place near Bannu which is called Kohat, and the on the mountain near Kohar, there is a stone, a big stone, which has Hebrew written on it.
Mm-hmm. Did they date?
Yeah.
From when?
Yeah. It's from, nobody knows. Okay. It's like, you go to Sawat Valley, where we talked about
Savatwe,
you see a lot of Hebrew inscriptions on the mountain.
Ancient.
Yeah, very ancient.
I'll be damned.
And then there is, like I said before, there's a tribe called Yusufzai. Yusuf is for Joseph, and Zai is sons of Joseph. Uh-huh. So Pashtuns have a long history.
Feel a little schizophrenic, do you? With all the various identity tracks that you can trace back? I mean, you got the whole world.
Why is everybody wanted to have Afghanistan? What is their position as such that everybody wants to have?
It's the heartland. It's a very strategic place. You have your...
Strategic as... Could you give me the geographical strategic...
It's the heartland of the Eurasian landmass.
Exactly. It's the heartland. You go into all these Central Asian states from here, and Central Asian states are very rich.
Very.
In minerals, yeah.
Samarkand.
But the
minerals,
oil, everything. Yeah.
Whoever rules the heartland will rule the world, and whoever rules Eurasia will rule the heartland.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The geostrategic
Mahan. If you remember to grind your knee
and George
to Kennan. Mountain top, it's Afghanistan.
Well,
it's hardcore grinding mountains.
In the times of the British Empire, when British had this were ruling India, this was a place to claim who is greater, whether the Russian Empire is greater, of the British Empire. They were all the time struggling for this place.
No question.
Land power against sea power.
Yeah. Now, considering the oil that is now in
Caspian,
in northern Russia, north of Afghanistan, the British didn't use oil.
No, no, it had nothing to do with oil.
At that time, it was different.
It was different. Now, yeah. What made it different? Why was it so extraordinarily important to take a shot at the underbelly of the, as you said?
It wasn't. It wasn't like that.
A conflict between Britain and Russia?
Yeah, yeah. It was not actually Britain taking a shot at the underbelly of the Russian, Tsarist Russian Empire. The geopolitical situation in that part of the world at that time was that there was...
At what time are you talking?
We're talking now of the time when Afghanistan came into being.
Yeah. 1700s to 1800s.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
When Afghanistan came into being, all right? He spoke of Ahmad Shah Durrani, 19th century, all right? So that is when Afghanistan came into being as a country. Mm-hmm. There was no country called Afghanistan. I said that earlier also. What is today Afghanistan was part of the following kingdoms and empires then.
Well, let him talk.
Sorry?
Let him talk.
Yeah.
He's going to spell them out, who they were.
Okay. Before the British, part of Afghanistan was part of the Mughal Empire, mm-hmm. and another part was part of the Persian Empire. Okay? Persian Empire had actually, by that time, not remained truly an empire because the Russians were expanding as an empire and Persia had begun to lose a lot of territories in Central Asia and Afghanistan's neighborhood to the Russian Empire. Okay, so then at that time it was the Russian Empire, the Tsarist Russian Empire, and the British Indian Empire, which were expanding into the area that is called Afghanistan. And it created a possibility of a direct confrontation between the British Indian Empire, which means Britain, and the Russian Central Asian Empire, which meant Russia.
Right.
And both Britain and Russia wanted to avoid that, and therefore it was agreed to retain a buffer area in between, which became the state of Afghanistan.
Right? With a lot of Pashtun.
Yes, I mean, it's not just only Pashtun.
No, I know.
In northern, north of the Hindu Kush, mm-hmm. are the non-Pashtuns, and south of the Hindu Kush are the Pashtuns. In fact, it was the Pashtun areas which were more part of the Mughal Empire, and the areas which are north of Hindu Kush were part of the Central Asian Khanates, mm-hmm. different Khanates.
How far north of the Hindu Kush do the Pashtuns go?
They don't actually... Okay, Pashtuns, some Pashtuns, of course, do live north of... I'm not a Pashtun,
most
of all.
People.
But some Pashtuns do live north of the Hindu Kush, but Pashtuns live north... Those who live north of the Hindu Kush are just, you know, sort of because it's part of their country, they go and live there. Otherwise, it's not a Pashtun area. The Pashtun area is south of the Hindu Kush.
Yeah, down past Kandahar?
Yeah. Yeah.
Past so Kandahar,
Kandahar,
and down
Kandahar,
to down Jalalabad, to the south,
Jalalabad,
down to the
Kabul,
south,
Jalalabad, all that.
Oh, to
way south.
Yes, Kandahar is south and eastwards. Okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So
that
is. The mountains are not. I mean, the mountains. The Hindu Kush do not divide Afghanistan neatly into north and south. Okay, they divide Afghanistan into north, northwest. And south, southwest, southeast. That's how the mountain range is.
Do they go down to Baluchistan?
So in the north, in the northern part, northwestern part, it is the Uzbeks and the Tajiks,
okay.
mostly. Some Turkoman. Uh-huh. In Badakhshan province, it is Ismailis who are in majority there. But
okay.
in the other part. Rest of it is Pashtuns.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, may I ask a silly, novel reading Westerner? How important is the Khyber Pass?
The Khyber Pass, you're saying? Mm-hmm.
The Khyber Pass connected the British Indian Empire with Afghanistan. Now it connects Pakistan with Afghanistan. The Khyber Pass is in Pakistan. All right? And there is also a misconception that Alexander the Great came through the Khyber Pass. Alexander the Great's army, when Alexander crossed into India from Central Asia, he came through Afghanistan, and as you might also know, that even Alexander was not able to pacify the Afghan tribes, and he had to marry.
The Afghan tribes, including Pashtun.
And he had to marry a shepherd
girl. Part
of
the Pashtun is part of the Afghan tribe.
He had to marry a shepherd girl in Afghanistan to win the favor of Afghan tribes and to get them on his side. And when he crossed into the Indian subcontinent, there were two efforts. Those who understand military strategy, they know what I'm saying. There are two, sort of huge columns which crossed into India. The larger column came through the Khyber Pass. But Alexander was not in that column. He crossed through a pass that's called the Nava Pass.
Nava?
It's further northwards of the Khyber Pass.
N-A-V-A?
N-A-V.
Nava.
Yeah, Nava Pass. So Alexander, with an auxiliary effort, came from that side, which was a very good military ruse for him to adopt at that time, because, you know, the Indian kings on the other side, they thought, he was coming through this one, but, you know, he was himself coming through another pass, and his main effort was going through Khyber Pass. So, but Khyber Pass is known in the Western world because of Alexander's army having gone through it, and, you know, on the
Rudyard Kipling.
And Rudyard Kipling,
Rudyard Kipling, of course.
But in the, if I could ask, in the after 79 with the Russian and then the resistance to the Russian occupation of that, there was a great deal of opposition to that. Was there a great deal of Pashtun involvement in the opposition to the Russian occupation of Afghanistan and to the militarily inclined opposition to that became successful in driving Russia out? Or what was the attitude or the role of the Pashtun people in that venture that we see in Charlie Wilson's war and in the real history of that area?
Pashtuns were a part of the struggle. It was all clans, all tribes of Afghanistan who took part in that struggle. Now, if you look at into the history of Afghanistan, and I would just go not really very far, but I'll stop at King Zahir Shah. Zahir Shah was the last king of Afghanistan, who was overthrown by Daoud.
When is this?
This is in 1960s, 70s?
So
that is where the whole thing started. Then Daoud Shah was overthrown by the communist people in Afghanistan, and then this communist regime was supported by the Russia, and they had a pact that whenever Afghanistan is in danger, Russia would come and help them. That's how Russia came into Afghanistan
in 79.
Because
the precept of helping.
There was a pact, a treaty. They didn't come in to say conquer Afghanistan. They came in to help a friendly regime.
But it was perceived as an outreach from the Russian Empire toward the Persian Gulf
as a thing, and that's how this whole struggle started. And you know, the whole story is given in the Charlie Winston War. That's one part of the story. There could be other parts of the story. But when this war started, it was almost a united front, and when I say that, it was almost all the tribes which took part in this.
Okay, including the Pashtuns. They're not Quakers. They will take up a rifle, or they will protect their own, and they have a warrior's historical. That's what I'm trying to say.
Pashtuns are the largest ethnic group in Afghanistan.
Yeah, but they are also able to resist occupation and so forth. They
have been doing it, and
they're not pacifists.
No.
Okay.
They don't like it.
Peshwari?
Peshawar is in.
Peshwari is in Pakistan. Is there a great deal of Pashtuns there?
It's all Pashtuns.
Everybody walks around with a rifle on their back.
Peshawar is more of an urban area. They don't really carry rifles. I would say the urban areas of Pakistan, do not really carry so much of rifles. But then there would be villages around Peshawar which would do that.
And they would all have rifles? Yeah.
Most.
Okay, I mean, okay. Okay. Yeah, I'm just trying to get
this rifle. You're talking about the, you know, people carrying rifles.
Yeah.
For a Pashtun,
yeah,
it is a sign of his being a man.
Okay.
His malehood and his being grown up, mm-hmm, that he must carry a rifle on his shoulder.
Like, okay? Davy Crockett.
But of course, yeah. But of course, when you say in Peshawar, obviously it doesn't happen. It can't happen in Peshawar. Peshawar is a city.
Oh, I see. Right? Okay, it's in that area. I was thinking that area. Okay.
I mean, you don't see it in urban area. Then you see it more in villages.
I'm thinking part of the identity of the
police station. It's your jewelry. Mm-hmm. Like a Pashtun child is born with a weapon.
Now, one important, do they have ammunition in those guns that they carry as jewelry? Okay.
I wish to share a story with you.
Yes, they do. Yeah. Most of them are licensed, sorry.
A simple story. I had to go from India during the Bangladesh War. I could not go through Pakistan. I had to go to Afghanistan, to Kabul. And what you said was most indicative. I'm in Kabul, and I didn't have too much money. So they had these little shops in Kabul for breakfast. Scalding milk, yogurt, lovely wheat bread, and honey. That was breakfast. And I was there with a friend who was an Islamic fellow. And all of a sudden, here comes through the door. This was a very small place. Very small. And he was a hillman.
He was a what?
Hillsman.
He had his turban on, his dresses, and he had a bag because he was bringing to the city honey from the hills. But he had his rifle on his back.
It's a great movie set. I mean,
but it was no rifle that an American like me ever saw. This was a musket.
World War I.
No. 1822.
Wow. Okay. One of those Anfield.
Yes, right.
Ones. It was a... You front loaders.
Yeah,
etc. It was polished. The wood was polished. The brass was polished.
Love it.
And he took it with pride across his shoulder.
Yeah.
And he had his packet of gunpowder, and his little fabrics, and he was bringing honey from the mountains.
Mm-hmm. There you go.
This was in Kabul.
Is that Pashtun?
Well, that's Pashtun. Like I said, the problem with Pashtuns is...
Yeah, there's mixture,
that,
difference.
No, your first enemy is your own cousin.
Your first enemy?
Your own cousin?
Yeah.
It's that's where it's
like me and my brother against my cousin. Our cousin against the rest of the tribe.
Stands out with.
Our tribe against the next tribe.
It's the largest.
And all Pashtuns against the rest of the world. So it works like that.
It's the largest.
It's not like national. It's not a national thing.
It's like we say nuclear family, extended family.
Exactly.
Yeah, kinship, clan, tribe.
Well,
you wouldn't call it a tribe?
We maybe say culture or heritage.
But what I'm talking about.
But you're talking about how if you're within your nuclear family, then that's your loyalty and those are your bonds. And then if the extended families are together, then all of a sudden there could be conflict that arises.
Yeah, but the reason that they carry guns is that the immediate relative that you have as your cousins, they're supposed to be your enemies also. So you are always prepared for that. But then your cousins are your friends against somebody out of the family.
A larger conflict.
And then your tribe is your friend against somebody from a... So this is why it is called... The unity among Pashtuns is so funny that they're all If you have to carry a weapon because you have enemies immediately within your family.
Right. The line that they stand on depends on the size of the conflict.
Yeah.
Mac, I want to say a word on that one.
But yeah, that is please.
And I say this out of my experience elsewhere in the world. And I have been in two other places which are very tribal. The people are very tribal in nature. I've been in Somalia and I've been in Georgia. Mm-hmm. And precisely the same kind of arrangement works in those tribal societies. It is myself, I against my brother, I and my brother against our cousin, I and our cousins against the rest of the tribe, and you know our tribe against the other tribe, and so on. It goes on. So as it keeps expanding, you know, you keep finding your allies who are closer to you, and you are, you know, you think you can fight the rest of the world. This was true among the tribes in Somalia, and it was true exactly in the same way among the tribes in Georgia. Uh-huh. And not just in it was true, the same kind of sayings that we are not talking of, about the Pashtuns, mm-hmm. also exist there. They say exactly the same things. Okay, so I think this is very peculiar to tribal culture. And
which is more widespread than we might know about here in the United States, in the world in general.
Yes,
it's very important
yes,
by which people get identity.
I mean, Africa,
Sub-Saharan
Africa.
Right.
I would say all of Sub-Saharan Africa is still tribal.
Yeah.
And a lot of places in Asia and Europe are tribal. I just mentioned a sort of quasi-European, I don't know, maybe I could just say
Georgia.
European. Georgia is European. Americans would want to think that Georgia is European.
Yeah.
Not that all Georgians think like that.
Oh,
some of my Georgian friends would say, oh, these Georgians don't know our Asian culture.
But we're talking about family.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
We're talking about family culture. Africa is all family culture south of the Sahara. It grows out of family. You don't marry family, so you're always extending. You're always grabbing new.
Yeah.
And I think that I'm also hearing stress. Stress from constant intervention from outside. Intervention that comes in, divides and conquers, and you use cousin.
Colonialism?
We call it colonization today. But I just wanted to talk about the intervention. Alexander didn't state
it. Later, okay.
So, I mean, you know, there's constant intervention. Somebody's coming, paying cousin, of giving cousin some honey or whatever, and cousin becomes an enemy. So, all these constant interventions, and you are at the crossroads of history where you've got constant traffic coming, going. Everybody wants to get to the crossroad and control the crossroad. To control the crossroad means that you control the king's highway. Control the king's highway is to control the world.
I think you bring in a very good point of crossroads. And Maggie was just asking us about why were people coming into Afghanistan. And I did say that there was no Afghanistan, of course, but that part of the world, that piece of geography existed, isn't
sure.
it? Always. And that piece of geography happens to be on the crossroads for any invader to the fertile plains of India.
Yeah.
So all the invaders who came from northwest, foreigners who occupied India came from the northwest, but for the British who came by sea and started from the east.
Yes.
McMahon. Everybody else came from the northwest.
McMahon. Yes. With sea power.
Yeah. That's right, because of the sea power.
It was on the Silk Route? Is it the Silk Route?
Silk Route is a much longer sort of... It starts from Italy and goes all the way into Central Asia.
Yeah, but does it come through there? It goes through Kashmir, does it? Or
Silk Route is not a... It's not one road, one track. Silk Route is an area, a corridor, a huge corridor.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
And
right.
it starts from Italy, comes through Central Asia, through India, through Pakistan, also Kashmir, it's a very vast tract of land, which was which carried the main highways of land-based trade in the olden times.
Mm-hmm.
So Afghanistan was part of that.
Yeah,
also.
It was.
But what I was saying was yes, crossroads of history, because this is interesting. People came through Afghanistan into India because it was a fertile area. And Georgia, again, is a place which was invaded by various people. It had been independent, had been under the Turks, had been under the Arabs, had been under the Russians until, of course, lately, till they became independent now. And again, at the crossroads of, by virtue of being in the south of Caucasus, at the crossroads of the world going into the Russian Empire of the olden days from the south, and of course, Caucasus then became the barrier for people to advance any further. So I agree with you, yes, entirely. All those places which lie at the crossroads of history, geographically, have this problem of a lot of invaders coming through, and they've had the advantage also of them becoming crucibles of various cultures and people coming from all places of the world, and you know, creating a new culture and a new society over there.
But why? Why target that?
Sorry,
she said, why target that? Why is there someone...
No, they don't target
maybe
that.
No,
Maggie, I was saying they passed through that. I was just saying in your absence that Afghanistan, for example, like I said, you know, there was no country Afghanistan, but the geography, the geographical land mass was there, the terrain was there, okay? And this was the area through which all invaders who came from Northwest went into the fertile plains of India, whether it was Alexander the Great or it was the Aryan tribes of Central Asia going into, you know, India, and of course others went to Europe, or it was the Afghan invaders who invaded India and established the religion of Islam in India, or others.
But if you had the money on there, then you must have had the invaders from the west as well, from China.
Buddhism.
From the east. From the east, you mean? This is the west.
Mm.
This is west of India. Now, do you mean from the east? The British are the only ones who came from the east because of their...
When you talk about Gandhar and you talk about the Bani and such and such, that was Buddhism.
Yeah.
Buddhism did not spread, and let me say this, Buddhism did not spread in that area by virtue of military power.
No.
Buddhism spread there because it was preached and taught by Buddhist people with Buddhist belief. And no, but I want to tell you this, and it spread in that area more strongly when King Ashoka of India, who became a Buddhist, and because all this area, Bamiyan included and Kabul included, and Delhi included, all this was part of his empire. It was called an empire, but it was not too huge an empire. I mean, it was not as big as the British Indian Empire. It was smaller. Right. A lot of southern parts of central and southern India and eastern India was not part of his kingdom. Right. So, when he became a Buddhist, then obviously Buddhism spread very quickly in a lot of parts of the then India, and this was part of then India, okay? These parts were in his empire. So, there have been different reasons at different times in history why certain things have happened.
Yeah. I wonder if we get back Pashtun, and does it go down into Baluchistan, or Baluchin, or comparable to the Baluchi area, or how far down south in Afghanistan does the tribal sway of the Pashtun extend? Maybe it's not clear cut, but
yeah, it's not clear cut. But you mentioned Baluchistan.
Yeah. That's Pakistan.
We do have. I mean, Baluchistan is again one province or one ethnic group, which is in two countries. It's in Iran as well as in Pakistan.
Right.
So Baluch are on both sides.
Right.
It's a Baluch ethnic group, but in Baluchistan you have Pashtuns also. So they have actually in Baluchistan Pashtuns are predominantly. They are a bigger ethnic group.
I wouldn't say that, but they are along the Afghan border.
Yeah.
are all Pashtuns.
Pashtuns? Yeah, the Pashtuns.
And along the Iranian border and in the hinterland.
That is Baluch. Yeah.
Well, it's really incumbent upon the world to understand better this Pashtun culture, it seems to me, don't you?
That, Harold,
I mean, there's such a focus on that now.
Harold, something's coming in through the chat. And they said that they want to know more about the importance of multimedia communications in the modern world with the Pashtuns.
Oh, okay.
Any comments?
Somebody off the internet is asking a question about media or multimedia. I guess, multimedia. And are they getting cell phones? Are they getting up to date? Or what do you want to know about? Yeah, this is one example, but maybe you could address it if you want. Yeah.
I think... You know, it's a question which has an answer in its own self. Multimedia has spread, and it has not stopped by borders. It has even gone into the most remote areas of Pakistan, and Pashtuns do live in the most remote areas. But the place where I come from is one of the most remote areas. That's Bannu. Even there, you have computers, and you have people on Facebook, and you have people blogging and chatting, and they could join you if it was the right time right now.
How is the bandwidth? When I was in Kashmir, the bandwidth was
The bandwidth has surprisingly improved. I'm very technical, but when I say it has improved, you don't have that blurry picture anymore. It's a much clearer picture when you use the camera. The bandwidth would be very good in Islamabad. It would be slightly poorer when you go into these rural areas or into the frontier, but again in Peshawar you would have a great bandwidth.
And in Lahore, of course, you have it.
Lahore again. It is surprising that probably sometime when I go back, we do have almost very compatible multimedia situation in Pakistan as we have here.
So until we get the guy with the laptop and the rifle, somebody wants to know, what do the Pashtuns think of us and us people? U.S.
Yeah, what view do the Pashtuns have of America?
We'll ask a Pashtun, and I'll
ask a Pashtun.
I will not respond to that. Yeah. Because if I respond to that, I will respond to the non-Pashtun.
A little over the dictum can be thrown in on Mr. Aziz's part, yeah. Yeah, what do you think the people's impression of the Western America is? Uh-oh, I got to get
it.
Get me the phone. Bring it. Just bring it. At the end of the table, just bring it here.
What would be the impression of Americans?
Hurry up.
About Pashtuns?
Well, we don't.
The reason I'm asking this question is, your impression would be what your media is telling you.
Okay, we'll send somebody.
It is
just
how much
lobby,
access
okay? We'll
you have
down,
to information.
Okay.
So. If you're listening to a certain type of media, a certain type of television, that's where you would be. You have different type of television channels here. You have Fox News, you have MSNBC, you have CNN, you have Bill Maher, and you have Daily Show with Jon Stewart. And if you listen to all of them, they are so different in their approach. But if you fix yourself to one type of media, you would have an impression of the world what that media keeps telling you. Now, how much access do the Pashtuns have to media? They didn't have much access a long time back. But you'll be surprised to know that the Pashtuns in the remotest part of their villages listen to BBC.
BBC.
Yeah.
Not British, Voice of America.
Not Voice British, of America. No, interesting.
British,
why?
British,
they trust the BBC.
Yeah, BBC. And BBC
is
has transmissions in Pashto.
In Pashto?
Yes. They have transmission in Pashto.
The BBC is a better source of information
so
in their mind?
BBC would be
it's not just
them.
A habit.
They speak the language. Voice of America probably doesn't. I don't know. Maybe they do.
Voice of America is not.
Why the heck wouldn't the Voice of America speak the language? It would be in their
it
interest. That's really
not,
what's
it was
important.
Not the empire that controlled this area.
Yeah.
So you're talking about the British empire,
just to answer the question, whatever, if they didn't have access to any of the media in some of the villages, whatever they would get from the newspapers which are available there, that's how they would be influenced. More and more, as they get access to the media, and now they have television has been there for some time, but again, it was limited. But more and more they get in access to the media through internet, people are changing.
Mm-hmm.
There's a war that Pashtuns are fighting themselves against extremism, and you all know that.
Yeah, that I wanted to ask about, yeah.
And that is also because they've been educated about it, that there's a better way to look at the world than to really listen to just one side of the story.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end, my point is that it is reaching up to those people. I have had some comments on my conversation, and I've seen that, you know, somebody commented that I'm from a very remote place, and I was very happy to see somebody speaking about Pashto. I mean, that's how they feel.
Mm.
So it's not that people would be against America or would be against West or something else. It is how much have they been, they've had access, and how much they have been informed. And that information is irrespective of whether you're in a Pashtun or whether you're in America.
Could I ask you something that might be confusing in the America, the attempt, or is there a conflating of Pashtun with Taliban? Or what is the Taliban in Afghanistan, what constitutes that? What is their identification they have? The group that we are, and Qaeda, that kind of thing. There is, in the minds of some Americans, to conflate the two. Could you set me straight on how Pashtun-Taliban conflation should be addressed, and how do we deal with that?
Well,
that question just crashed the computer.
Oh, dear. Well,
just restarted.
I know. No.
The simplest way I would say is to answer that question is that some time back, all Talibans were Pashtuns.
Okay.
But all Pashtuns were not Taliban.
I can understand. Yeah.
So all Talibans were Pashtun because this whole movement of Taliban started from the time when there was this fight against Russia. And it started in the Pashtun area because that was bordering Afghanistan.
Kandahar or?
No. I'm talking of the tribal area or across the border.
Uh-huh.
That was the area which was the easiest to have your people to fight the Russians.
So the active response to the occupation of Russia was something that was birthed in a serious way within the Pashtun culture?
It wasn't that. It was more of the convenience of the ground.
Oh.
If, for example, Punjab was bordering Afghanistan,
right,
maybe it would have been more Punjabis involved with it. It was more of the convenience where this training camps could be established. It was the proximity.
Were there people,
actually the ethnicity which really was.
Were there other ethnic groups in the north or something that might have wanted been like what have been called running dogs to the Russian people who were coming in to occupy, or from the British who were there before, in terms of...
But was there
opposition to the British occupation
was
it strong traditionally among the Pashtun particularly?
I'm saying
it sounds to me like they're an upright... group of people who are defending their
tradition. The British could never subdue this area.
The Pashtuns, particularly.
The Pashtun area was never subdued by the British. Most of it.
Well,
especially
all right.
Across.
That is important, particularly if it's a core area of this kind of attitude toward occupation. They don't like it.
Well, it is.
I mean, that's simple.
Somebody here is saying Taliban is a cult. Is that true?
No, I don't think. Okay, maybe there's a need for a bit of a more explanation. But
yes,
because Harold, you asked this question precisely about Taliban. We must know how did the Taliban phenomenon come into being?
Mm.
After the withdrawal of the Soviet troops from Afghanistan, unfortunately, the United States left Afghanistan to itself and its neighbor Pakistan and withdrew its own. Support also, which support was provided when the war against the Soviet occupation was going on.
Mm-hmm.
So when that happened, after withdrawal of the Soviet forces, President Najibullah had established a government in Afghanistan. He was also protege of the Russians, and he established a socialist government in Afghanistan. But his government's writ was did not go anywhere beyond
Kabul. Yeah.
Kabul was,
yeah.
was it. Okay.
Like Karzai.
And the rest of the country was governed and ruled by warlords. And warlords were a big menace to all the Afghan people, Pashtun and non-Pashtun.
Are there warlords within the overall Pashtun nation, or like
no, no, they were
mafia
they
dons or something, or no, how do we say it?
Let me complete this thing, but on that question of whether warlords are within the Pashtun nation, no, warlords are within the Pashtun people and the non and the Tajiks and the Uzbeks and the Hazaras and everybody. Okay?
And the Italians.
Yeah,
we call them Don. Yeah, yeah, Don Corleone. Yeah, yeah.
The mafia. Okay, but I just want to finish that.
I'm sorry.
Okay, so and then in Kandahar, you know, like I said, everybody was sick of the machinations and the excesses of the warlords, all right? And people couldn't move freely because warlords would put, you know, road barriers. They would have to pay taxes to every, you know, few miles because of the new warlords' territory and all that. So it was in Kandahar that a small group of people who were students of religious seminaries, that is what Taliban mean, student of a religious seminary.
Really, that's what that means?
Yes,
I didn't know that.
Means
okay.
Student of a religious, students is the plural. Talib is the singular. Mm. Taliban is the plural of that.
Okay, thank you.
So Taliban means students of religious seminary. So a group of students under this person who's known as Mullah Omar, who is the head of all Taliban in Afghanistan. So they got sick of, you know, some warlord, and they went and demolished their road barriers. They also had weapons, okay?
Yeah.
Used their weapons. They said, okay, we are taking control of this, and you're not going to have this. And then this became popular, all right? This was a popular thing to do.
You had a lot of weapons sloshing around.
Exactly. So this became popular, and the Taliban began to expand. Now, I must say here that the United States and Pakistan supported the creation of the Taliban then, all right? And there was money coming from the United States, there was money coming from the Middle East, and Pakistan was, of course, supporting them. And so much so that the Taliban began to expand and went and occupied Kabul also. Right. When that happened, three countries in the world recognized the Taliban regime. Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, and UAE. Mm-hmm. And the United States did not object to that at that time. The United States kept on supporting and giving money.
Lots of it by then, yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't have figures, really. No. But what we do know is that U.S. was supportive of that. Al-Qaeda, because somebody said, you know, Taliban and Al-Qaeda, we must differentiate between the two. Taliban are not Al-Qaeda. Mm-hmm. Al-Qaeda is a different phenomenon altogether. Al-Qaeda are basically Arabs.
Arab, yeah.
Okay? And Al-Qaeda, Al-Qaeda's connection with Taliban...
Before we continue to...
Yeah, she wants to say...
Al-Qaeda, can I ask you, can you go over warlords again and where they come from and how that happens?
Oh, they didn't come from anywhere outside.
Oh, excuse me, before you say that, somebody here was saying that there's Mullah Omar.
Yes, right.
And she's saying, we don't know how they came about. Do we know?
But I just said Mullah Omar was also among those students in Kandahar who became the first group of Taliban. And you asked that question, who these warlords were. Okay, when... I just said, when the jihad, the U.S. supported, Pakistan supported, jihad was undertaken, Charlie Wilson's war, Charlie Wilson's
great
war.
Great war movie.
When that was undertaken in Afghanistan against the Soviet occupation, it was not the Pakistani and American forces that were fighting there. What they did was that they created opposition, they supported opposition to the occupation within Afghanistan. And when they began to support that opposition, some of those people, those tribal, from various tribes, emerged as the warlords, all right? As the leaders of those tribes who were leading either militarily or because of their political influence in that tribe, and through whom money and weapons were channeled to those fighters who were fighting against the Soviet occupation. So when the Soviets withdrew, these warlords remained, and they had become now so powerful and so used to having their way by use of weapons that they became a menace for the very people of Afghanistan. That's what happened.
The history of the warlords were basically, they were small militias. And these militias were, some of them were not based on tribe, they were based on religious. Within Sunnis and Shias, we have different religious beliefs. So you have all these warlords like, again, the names now. They were heading their own little factions. So they were very small. Hakani and all that. They were very small. But when, after the Russian invasion, and when they got support from the West, they started growing and started recruiting people. Now, Taliban is not just restricted to Kandahar. Taliban means everywhere in Northwest Frontier Province, in every little village, you have a mosque, and you have these little kids who go there to learn about Islam because they are called Talibs. They were never institutionalized before the Afghan war, before this, you know, fighting. But during that time, everybody got so many weapons, they become a little training school for people. So, just like General Bajwa said, that when the Russians left, there was a huge vacuum. These warlords could not manage Afghanistan. There was nobody to put them together. And the Taliban, who were very poor but who had weapons, filled in that vacuum. They started creating peace in small areas. So in a Taliban area, you just could walk freely, you could walk without weapons, there were no drugs, there was zero crime.
What year?
After the Russians left in 1989, mm-hmm. till the Taliban were in, say, till 2001, I would say for about
96 to 2001.
Yeah, for about 5-6 years, when they were there, there was no weapons, there was nothing. So the people generally, you know, those who didn't really care much about education, because there was no education anyway, there were no jobs. People were more interested in security and in their little living rather than schools or burqas. So they, you know, they're providing us peace. There are no more weapons, you know, there's no more
security.
So that little thing made the difference, and that's how Taliban were able to go around the whole Afghanistan and were able to do it.
I have two people with the same question. Now,
yeah, sorry.
They say, how can the U.S. resolve the issues in Afghanistan and Pakistan so they could get out of that reason? And the second one is, do the people like the Taliban, or do they want them out?
Okay, now I just want to link this to Al-Qaeda. Now, Osama bin Laden was always there. He was there long since, you know, before we even knew about Al-Qaeda. It's only when he created this, because they were fighting Russia, and then Russia was gone, and now they felt probably they've been abandoned, so that's how Al-Qaeda came into being. And they were very close to Taliban because they were financing Taliban and this sort of. So they were getting protection from Taliban. That's how this whole thing happened.
Osama bin Laden was financing Taliban?
Osama bin Laden was a very rich person.
I'd like to interject. I'd like to interject here. We've come to the end of a tape. So we're going to change the tape now. So everybody just sit still. Don't say anything, because we're going to put another tape in. And if it's not on tape, In the media world, it doesn't exist. So everybody just sit still for 20 seconds. Don't say anything meaningful until the tape is running. Are we agreed?
We'll agree.
Quiet. Don't walk around.
That's the best time to talk.